Quantum mechanics is the strangest and most mind-bending branch of physics. It is where the very fabric of reality behaves in ways that defy common sense. In the quantum realm, particles can be in two places at once, teleport across space through quantum entanglement, and even change their state simply by being observed. Despite its paradoxes, quantum mechanics underpins modern technology, from transistors to quantum computing. The quantum phenomenon is equally mysterious and jaw-dropping. Richard Feynman, a legendary physicist, once said, "I think I can safely say that nobody really understands quantum mechanics. But we're here to try anyways."
Welcome to the Mysteries of Quantum Mechanics Simplified, where we unravel the mysteries of the universe, one quantum puzzle at a time. It's a show where we step into the realm of the very small, where reality itself begins to behave in unexpected ways. From the birth of quantum mechanics to its strangest paradoxes, we'll explore how our understanding of physics was shattered and rebuilt. I am your host, Inara, part of the Turing's physics editorial team and self-appointed translator of physics speak into everyday language.
I'm Jessica, your guide to the quantum world. Together, we will be your host through the journey into the world of quantum mechanics. Trust us, nothing in classical physics prepares us for what quantum mechanics unravels. Welcome to our first episode. What better place to start this journey than the way? All great revolutions do with a crisis, a moment when the old ways of thinking no longer work. And for physics, that moment came at the dawn of the 20th century. For centuries, physics was ruled by certainty. It was an age where the laws of nature were seen as absolute, guiding everything from the fall of an apple to the motion of planets. Classical physics, as we call it today, was a grand achievement, a theory of everything known at the time.
And the theory had some heavyweight architects.
The greats such as Galileo Galilei, Johannes Kepler, or Isaac Newton. Each of them made fundamental contributions to our understanding of the universe. Galileo, in the early 17th century, championed the scientific method, refining the telescope to study celestial bodies and providing evidence that the Earth orbits the sun. His laws of motion laid the groundwork for Newton's later work. Johannes Kepler, through meticulous analysis of astronomical data, formulated the three laws of planetary motion, showing that planets move in elliptical orbits rather than perfect circles, and that their speeds vary depending on their distance from the sun. His work bridged observational astronomy and physics, paving the way for Newton. Finally, Isaac Newton unified these insights with his Principia Mathematica, formulating the three laws of motion and the universal law of gravitation, establishing the idea that the same physical laws govern both the heavens and the earth. Together, these giants of science described the world as a vast, predictable machine, where every force and every motion could be calculated with precision.
It sounds like classical mechanics left nothing to chance.
Exactly. This was the world of determinism. The universe was seen as a grand clockwork mechanism ticking in perfect order. Classical physics was incredibly successful at explaining countless natural phenomena with astonishing precision. Newton's laws predicted planetary orbits with such accuracy that they enabled the discovery of Neptune in 1846, based purely on perturbations in Uranus's motion. The laws of fluid dynamics, based on classical mechanics, helped engineers design ships and bridges, while thermodynamics explained how heat engines worked, paving the way for the Industrial Revolution. Maxwell's equations unified electricity and magnetism, leading to the advent of radio waves, electric power, and telecommunications. Every major scientific and technological breakthrough seemed to reinforce the idea that the universe operated according to unbreakable, deterministic laws. This philosophy reached its pinnacle in the 19th century with Pierre-Simon Laplace's demon.
Laplace's demon sounds ominous.
Not so much ominous as ambitious. Laplace was a French mathematician who made significant contributions to probability, astronomy, and physics. He suggested that if there were an all-knowing intelligence, which some referred to as his demon, who knew the exact position and velocity of every particle in the universe, it could calculate the entire past and future with perfect accuracy.
So according to Laplace, the universe was just a series of dominoes, each event triggering the next, forever predictable?
Precisely. Everything from the orbits of planets to the motion of molecules followed Newtonian laws, leaving no room for randomness. This philosophy shaped science, engineering, and even our understanding of society. Industrial machines, bridges, locomotives, everything was designed under the assumption that the universe was orderly and predictable.
That's oddly comforting, knowing that the universe follows rules we can understand. So, where did it go wrong?
Well, the cracks in classical physics were subtle at first, but they grew into gaping holes. The world of the very small, the atomic and subatomic realm, did not obey Newton's laws at all. Instead, it behaved in ways that defied logic and intuition. That's when physics ran into a wall.
That sounds dramatic. What exactly happened?
The problem started with something called black body radiation. Imagine you heat up a piece of iron until it glows red, then white. Classical physics could explain why it changed color using equations based on electromagnetism and thermodynamics. The idea was that all objects emit thermal radiation, and as they get hotter, they emit more energy across a range of wavelengths. According to classical physics, this energy emission should be smooth and continuous with increasing intensity as the wavelength decreases. The theory predicted that at higher and higher frequencies, especially in the ultraviolet range, the energy emitted should keep increasing indefinitely. This meant that in theory, an object should emit an infinite amount of energy at very short wavelengths, which is clearly impossible. This absurd prediction became known as the ultraviolet catastrophe.
Infinite energy? That doesn't make any sense.
Not at all. In reality, objects do not keep emitting more and more energy at higher frequencies. Instead, the intensity of radiation peaks at a certain wavelength and then drops off at shorter wavelengths. This means that rather than producing an ever-increasing amount of ultraviolet radiation, as classical physics predicted, real black bodies exhibit a well-defined spectrum of emitted energy. Physicists observed that as temperature increased, the peak of the emitted energy shifted to shorter wavelengths, explaining why heated objects transition from red to blue as they get hotter. The experimental data showed a perfect smooth curve where energy emission peaked at a specific point and then tapered off, directly contradicting classical predictions. But at the time, classical physics had no mechanism to explain why this happened.
So physicists were stumped?
Completely. The equations they trusted, the very same equations that had successfully predicted planetary motion, the mechanics of fluids and electromagnetic waves, suddenly gave nonsensical results when applied to black body radiation. Something was missing. And then along came Max Planck. Planck wasn't looking to shake the foundations of physics. He was simply trying to fix an equation. In 1900, he found a mathematical trick that made the infinite energy problem disappear.
What sort of trick?
His trick was actually the first step toward quantum mechanics. He suggested that energy isn't emitted continuously, like classical physics assumed, but in discrete packets, quanta. This idea was radical, and Planck himself didn't fully believe it at first. But when he used this assumption, suddenly the math worked.
So instead of energy flowing out smoothly, it jumps in steps?
Yes. Think of it like climbing stairs instead of walking up a ramp. Energy can only be emitted or absorbed in these fixed amounts. This was a completely new way of thinking about nature.
And this solved the ultraviolet catastrophe?
It did. When Planck applied his idea, his equation perfectly matched experimental results. No more infinite energy predictions. But this simple fix came with an unsettling implication, one that would shake physics to its core. Even Planck himself was skeptical. He saw his equation as a useful mathematical trick, not a fundamental law of nature. To him, quantization was just a desperate attempt to fit the experimental data, nothing more. For years, he resisted the idea that nature itself might be quantized. Planck was a staunch believer in classical physics, and the notion that energy could only be exchanged in discrete packets contradicted everything he had been taught. The very idea of discontinuous energy went against the prevailing belief in smooth, predictable laws of motion and electromagnetism. but Planck had no other choice. When he applied his assumption, reluctantly, that energy could only be emitted in discrete amounts proportional to their frequency, the mathematics suddenly made perfect sense. The ultraviolet catastrophe vanished. His equation fit experimental data perfectly. He later wrote that he had introduced quantization as an act of desperation, never truly believing it would revolutionize physics. And he was not alone in his skepticism. Many of his peers dismissed the idea. The great physicists of the time, including Ludwig Boltzmann and Hendrik Lorentz, were hesitant to embrace such a radical departure from classical thinking. To them, Planck's solution was a mathematical convenience, not a real description of nature. But a few, like Einstein, saw something deeper. Just a few years later, Einstein took Planck's idea and pushed it further than anyone. He proposed that light itself is made of discrete packets, particles, we now call photons. This was an even greater shock to the physics community. Planck had suggested quantization reluctantly. Einstein embraced it fully, challenging the deeply held belief that light was purely a wave. That's when physics truly started to unravel. Planck's idea solved one problem, but led to an even deeper mystery, one that would eventually give birth to quantum mechanics. The controversy that followed would divide physicists for years and set the stage for the quantum revolution.
I have a feeling things are about to get a whole lot weirder.
Oh, you have no idea. There was another puzzle, one that was just as baffling. Why do atoms emit light in specific colors? If you look at the light from the sun or a candle, it appears smooth and continuous. But if you take that light and pass it through a prism, you should get a full rainbow of colors, blending seamlessly from red to violet. That's what classical physics predicted, continuous emission. But when scientists studied the light from heated gases like hydrogen, they saw something completely different.
Different how?
Instead of a full rainbow, they saw discrete lines, sharp, isolated bands of color at specific wavelengths. No blending, no smooth transition, just specific colors appearing while others were missing entirely. This was totally unexpected. It was as if nature had imposed strict rules on how atoms could emit light.
And classical physics had no explanation for this?
Not really. According to classical physics, electrons orbit the nucleus like planets around the sun. That meant they should be able to emit energy in a continuous range, just like a vibrating string can produce different musical notes. But that's not what experiments showed. Instead, atoms seem to emit light only at very specific wavelengths, as if they were somehow quantized. Niels Bohr eventually addressed this by proposing that electrons occupy specific energy levels and can jump between them, emitting or absorbing photons of specific energies.
So physicists had an atomic model that predicted one thing and experiments showed something else entirely?
Exactly. And it got even worse. According to classical electromagnetism, orbiting electrons should constantly lose energy and spiral into the nucleus within a fraction of a second. But atoms were stable. Something was keeping electrons from collapsing into the nucleus, and classical physics had no idea why.
So with another mystery and another crack in classical physics?
Yes. The atomic spectra problem and the stability of atoms were two gaping holes in our understanding. It was becoming clear that a completely new way of thinking about physics was needed. These problems shattered the certainty of classical physics. Physicists faced a dilemma: reject the evidence or rethink reality itself. The universe was speaking, and its message was clear. Our understanding of physics was incomplete. This was the birth of quantum mechanics, a radical new framework that would soon redefine our understanding of the microscopic world.
So this was the moment when reality itself seemed to change?
Yes, enter physicists such as Max Planck, Albert Einstein, and Niels Bohr, each of whom will go on to become a legend. Each of them would play a crucial role in reshaping physics. The 20th century would become the battleground for a new war in physics, a war of ideas, of intuition against evidence, of classical certainty against quantum chaos. And it all started with Max Planck, the man who unknowingly set the revolution in motion. He would unlock a door that could never be closed, forever altering the course of science.
And where does that door lead?
from the wonderful world of quantum mechanics to a world where energy is not smooth but granular, where particles exist in multiple places at once, where certainty is replaced by probabilities. It all began with a single question. What if energy comes in packets? What if nature itself is quantized? And that is where we begin our next episode, Planck's Quantum Hypothesis.